Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint. We thank you for keeping it Urban TV. We hope out there you're wearing your mask. We hope you're sanitizing. We hope you're social distancing because COVID-19 is real and it does kill. On The Checkpoint tonight, we have the Executive Director, Uganda Manufacturers Association, Daniel Birungi. My name is Nicholas Wasanja. Now, we are all aware that the East African Community Common Market Protocol guarantees unfettered free movement of goods and services between member states. But the reality, if you look at the unfolding of events in the last 1-2 years, is that member states are not playing, literally playing a different ballgame. Daniel, welcome to the show. You remember very well that early this year, Uganda's trade with Rwanda was down to, you could call it a trickle. We had a frosty relationship politically, and that in a way hampered trade between Uganda and Rwanda. On the other hand, Tanzania at some point had a bad import of timber, sugar, and I think maize. Kenya's market was open to things like maize and beans, but when it came to finished products like, say, dairy products from Uganda, we've had long-standing issues that I think are still going on. South Sudan has an open market, but you cannot say you can rely on it because of the political strife that is within the country internally. Could we say the East African Community Market Common Market Protocol and the Customs Union Protocol are a facade?
Thank you very much, Nicholas, and thanks to Urban for inviting us. Our feeling as the UMA is that the Common Market Protocol, while it has not failed, because indeed there is still a level of trade among our partner states, it requires significant support for its ideals to be realized. You've rightly pointed out that we live in a time when access to Rwanda is unpredictable and unable to be carried on. We live in a time when access to Kenya is happening in some areas, but in a lot of other areas there are restrictions. Access to Tanzania, same story. And our argument as the Manufacturers Association has been to say that it's time that we stood up to identify the gaps in implementation of the Common Market Protocol. Our feeling, our belief is that some of these gaps are occasioned by the fact that we do not give power to an entity such as the East African Community Secretariat to arbitrate and resolve disputes that arise out of implementation of these protocols. Because if that was the case, we would not be here. Many of us have seen the example that is in the European Union, the fact that because the European Union Commission is empowered to carry on some of the dispute resolution measures, they're able to sanction errant partner states. And that then ensures that you then don't have to rely on political goodwill to move decisions forward, but rather systems are in place to ensure that irrespective of when it happens, even if you're in the middle of a campaign season like we are, they are technocrats able to take decisions that are binding on these partner states.
Well, Birungi, when you talk about support, what kind of support? Because when you talk of empowering the secretariat, I mean, you have institutions in place. You have the East African Court of Justice. You have an assembly, the IALA. You have all these councils of ministers and all that. What kind of support? I would say that the secretariat is well funded. What kind of support do you exactly want as manufacturers to enable free trade within the community?
Okay, as it is today, the secretariat can only appeal to the Council of Ministers and then onwards to the summit of heads of state for decisions to be made within the East African Community arrangement. That is a direct weakness of the system. Because it then means that a technical process is beholden to politics. And that decisions at this, at the level of the organs, is reliant on endorsement by the political angle. This then means that, for example, if the East African Court of Justice issues an injunction against the Republic of Uganda, you do not necessarily have the structures in place to implement the injunction. Many a case have been decided in this East African region by the Court of Justice, and the partner states have not gone ahead to implement these decisions. Meaning that, yes, you get the decision, but you're left with the decision because you're unable to move it forward. And what we are appealing for is a situation where these decisions are enforceable, a situation where failure to abide comes with strict sanctions. We know what has been going on in the region. We know, for example, what's going on in South Sudan, which is a member of the community. If we had functioning structures that are able to sanction these incidences, we would be in a position where South Sudan would probably be in a timeout right now to say, look, you do not qualify because of A, B, C, D, and as such, get your house in order before we can actually relate with you. And these are the kind of initiatives that we are seeking to see put in place. Of course, the painful part of that is that it requires we as the community, because we are all in the community, it requires we, the citizens, to then appeal to our leaders to cede sovereignty, because it requires you to give up a level of sovereignty as a country and say, look, on these particular issues, because they are critical and the foundation for our East African community, we shall cede powers to a higher body that is then given the powers to arbitrate and conclude these discussions.
When you talk of some of these trade challenges, some scholars and writers have referred to them as trade wars, which I would a term that I would not like to use. But these trade challenges, in real terms, how much would you say the manufacturers in Uganda have been affected?
Nicholas, I'll extend it beyond just the manufacturers and also go down to the community level. At the manufacturing level, I can tell you that over the past 1.5 years, our estimate is that Uganda has lost 105,000 jobs as a result of these trade challenges. As a result of these trade challenges, I can tell you that one particular player in the dairy sector has, over the course of this year, lost $75 million because of these challenges. As a result of these challenges, we have 250,000 metric tons of sugar stuck in our bonds, unable to be sold. The impact of that is, as a manufacturer of sugar, I then cut down on my production. And this is then where we get to the community. Because if you took a ride today to the eastern region, which is the sugar belt of Uganda, you would find that sugarcane are overgrown in the gardens because the uptake is not equivalent to the growth. That has meant that farmers are left stranded with the decision on either to just give the sugar canes away at giveaway prices or cut their chambers and repurpose them to something else. Long term, we're going to face two issues. Number one, we have a challenge of our sugar factories running out of sugarcane as we go along because the farmers are moving out of that area. Secondly, we have the problem of communities that had come to rely on the finances from sugar also suffering, figuring out where else to get the money. Now, that is just the sugar side. If I take you to the dairy sector, they will tell you, if you ask the farmers in Western Uganda, that about a year and a half or 2 years ago, prices had hit a peak of 1,000 shillings per liter. Right now, you're fortunate if someone comes to you and offers you 300 shillings per liter. Mark you, the 300 shillings per litre...
That's the farm gate price.
That's the farm gate price. The 300 shillings per litre is not sufficient to manage a farm because you have feeds, you have a lot of other investments that go along with that. The impact of that is a lot of the farmers we've spoken to are turning away from dairy farming and moving on to maybe beef or some other forms of farming. And this is not good. This is not sustainable for us. Because if there is one thing we had done right 2 years ago, is that we got to a point where we were now competitive continent-wise in terms of supplies of milk. Right now, we've let that fizzle away, which means the foreign exchange earnings that we were making from that have also gone out of the window. So the problem is not just related to manufacturing. This is a problem of manufacturing, yes, but it's also a problem of our farmers. What happens to them going forward? It's a problem of our children. Of the 105,000 jobs, this is not a time for us to lose jobs, given our demographic bulge as a country. This is a time for us to grow more jobs. But even then, as we move to become part of the African Continental Free Trade Area, the opportunities that are opening up at continental level require unity of purpose at regional level. We do not have that unity of purpose. Doesn't that then make us a certain direction for products coming from elsewhere, from other regions to infiltrate our market?
But you see, Daniel, you speak very passionately when you're describing the challenges that the manufacturers are facing and what that would mean for Uganda's trade at the continental level and globally. But I'm going to challenge you on this. It seems, and well, you're not a politician, but for me, that's how the community, the regional bloc, has been designed. It has been designed by the technocrats, the politicians on the one side, and the people being left on the other side. You said that you had gotten to a point where Uganda was becoming very strong in terms of supplying dairy products and all that. You get it. But I'll challenge you that the local farmer down in Western Uganda, who sells at the farm gate, has not been able to benefit, and where the problem that poses is that while you as manufacturers you decry the current situation, you're not carrying the people along, so nobody is willing to listen to you. It's a conversation that is dragging because the people are absent, because at the end of the day, you the manufacturers, when you're making a killing in the East African in the East African market, you're not considering the local person down there.
My feedback to that would be that it's an erroneous thesis to say that to delink manufacturing from the farm. And here is why. I give you an example of the price of milk. At the peak of our exports, manufacturers, farm gate, were paying 1,000 shillings per litre. As a result of this disruption, that price has dropped to 300 shillings a litre. Who in the end is then losing that 700 shillings? It is the farmer. And believe you me, if you went right now to Western Uganda, pick any random cooperative, ask them about the state of their supplies, they'll tell you exactly the same thing, that look, we had better days, but now it's suffering. Sugarcane, same story. About 2 years, 1.5 to 2 years ago, the land prices in Busoga region in particular, had soared. Reason being, people were looking for any space to set up sugarcane plantations because it was an assured win. Go to a town like Mayuge, for example. A town like Mayuge was a backwater. Right now, built on the back of the sugar industry, that town is a thriving metropolis. And it could even be bigger. So the thesis that manufacturing gains do not trickle down to the final person, to the muntu wa wansi, so to speak, the farmer at the farm gate level, I think is erroneous. And this is the argument we are now pushing forward. You're right on critiquing us to say that perhaps we need to do more around bringing the farmers to the table as well, so that they can articulate some of these issues. And that's the part that we've failed on so far. But that's why we are engaging the media now to say, look, don't only talk to us. When you're doing a story about this, it's not a story about manufacturing. Yes, manufacturing is suffering, given. But this is a story about the Ugandan farmer, about the farmer down there who is looking to send their child to school but cannot afford it, about the young man who has graduated, has suddenly gotten a job, and then the factory has to tell him, look, because our supplies are not consistent, we have to let you go until such a time that we are better. It hits us right there. And so that's the story we are now telling.
Partner states, to be fair to them, raise questions of originality, authenticity of goods that quote unquote are manufactured in Uganda. He say you import sugar from Brazil, you come and repackage from Uganda and then resell to Tanzania. You the same story about the dairy industry. How true is this allegation?
Nicholas, you see, this is where the discussion we started with on structures comes in. That under the ESC, we have parameters through which you supply another country. We have parameters through which originality is measured. This is what they call a certificate of origin, issued by a competent authority in the originating country, that indicates that this product, without a doubt, has local content of this country to a level that allows it to be an East African product. Now, our argument with our partners is that they have ignored these provisions and gone ahead to speculate about the originality of our items, even when these items have valid certificates of origin, which can be verified. I'll give you one outlandish example that has been quoted out there by some of our partners, that we as Uganda have developed the sophistication and the financing to go all the way to Belgium, source milk powder, import it via Saudi Arabia, take it to Congo and transship it to Western Uganda, get water, dilute it, pack it again, and then drive it all the way to Kenya and then sell it to them as milk. You and I both know that even as I speak, farmers are pouring milk in Western Uganda. What they forget is that there's been initiatives in place to drive the growth of capacity in some of these areas. And when this capacity suddenly hits them in the face, it's now a case of, oh, it cannot be that you have this capacity. I think this is a vestige of the period when Uganda was pretty much a supermarket for Kenyan products. There is that, I would call it likeness for going back in the past and getting us to that point. And we're telling them, no, you cannot have your cake and eat it. We are part of an East African community that has enabled you to sell some of your products to Uganda. Granted, what we are only asking for is that, no, you do not give us competitive, special advantage, but allow our products to get on your shelves. Let the consumer pick based on quality, based on price, based on packaging, but let us be on the shelf along with you. We'll outcompete you anytime.
But you remember at the peak of Uganda and Kenya about the dairy industry, at the peak of that, there was a team that came from Uganda, from Kenya, a select team that came from Kenya to come and inspect the question of originality. The report that came out of that visit has never seen the light of day. People went to Western Uganda, and that raises a question of corruption. You talked about a certificate of originality. Corruption is a sad story in Uganda, to say, and many of the other East African countries. Don't you think this is at the center of the problem?
Nicholas, I wouldn't like to speculate about that, but what I would say to that is this. Kenya has actually sent not one, but two verification teams to Uganda. The first one went back and said, look, the milk is sourced in Uganda, it's sustainably sourced, its quality is guaranteed, let's get rid of these non-tariff barriers and move on. That was ignored. They sent a secondary team to verify the findings of the first team. That's the one whose report is not seen. But I can tell you that anecdotal evidence, based on interactions that our members have had with some of the people who came through, is that there was a level of shock at the level of sophistication that has been developed in this sector. Because if you are a Ugandan and you take the route to Mbarara or that side anytime, you will notice there are quite a number of factories that have been set up. High-grade factories, by the way, millions of dollars of investment that are focusing on this particular area. We have a dairy development authority that is also doing some work in this area. And there's been significant movement. Now that is unacceptable. And we're saying it's unfair. It's unfair. It can't be that each time we reach the goalpost, you move it a few steps further. We've done the verifications, and incidentally, our members are quick to say, look, If what is required is a third verification, bring it on. Come and verify all you want. Bring international verifiers if you want. We have no problem with that. But for goodness sake, once we meet the parameters, let go of the barriers and let us move on with trade.
Don't you think, as manufacturers in the region, it's time you face the reality of agreeing to comparative advantage in terms of production? Because I mean, if I'm Kenya, for Christ's sake, and I also have dairy farmers, it's going to be very complicated for me to open my market wide open. Uganda is blessed to be able to produce more than one thing in the agriculture sector. You can produce coffee, you can produce banana, there are so many things that you can produce for the rest of the region to consume. Don't you think the time has come for you to start, as manufacturers, to look at where do we have the edge over our neighbors so that we do not compete over the same, because it seems like that is the other challenge, so that we don't compete over the same goods and services. Mm.
But Nicholas, then where is the limit? Because if every time you get competitive advantage in an area, that area is off limits, then we might as well close shop and say, look, factories in Uganda, it's not something we do. Go set up in Kenya, you'll still supply Uganda, which is actually already happening. There are some movements in that direction. Close shop in Uganda, we will supply from elsewhere. And then let's focus on, I don't know, singing, picking grasshoppers, perhaps that's what we should be good at. Mm. But we live in a world trade economy. World trade dictates, and the free market economy dictates, that as a private sector, if you determine that you have competitive advantage in an area, invest and let the goods compete on the same basis. And that is what we're saying, that look, yes, we've developed that competitive advantage. And incidentally, even if you look at it from the welfare perspective, don't Kenyan citizens deserve good quality affordable milk? Are we then saying that Kenya should restrict their citizens to expensive milk because Uganda can supply the cheaper milk, expensive sugar because Uganda can supply cheaper sugar but should be stopped? I think that all runs counter to the aspirations of the EAC treaty, because the EAC treaty, the preamble to the EAC treaty says it must be people-centered and private sector-driven. I believe right now it's political-centered and political-driven, which is unfortunate and which runs counter to why we set this up. If you will recall our history, the first EAC failed because of politics. We do not want another failure on our hands. And fortunately for Uganda, we've been committed. We've been committed to regional trade. We've done everything in our powers to make it happen. But it's time that our members, our neighbors, played ball as well. It's not a one-man show. We need to work together.
Some experts going to the treaty and how our institutions have been structured. I would say, as an expert in manufacturing and trade, how do you look at how the entire treaty and the protocols have come into place? Because some scholars argue that probably we moved too fast to realizing the customs union protocol and then the common market protocol before establishing the preferential trade area and the free trade area.
Nicholas, I can't say I'm a trade expert, neither am I a manufacturing expert, incidentally. But what I can say is, I think there's a lot of thought and negotiation that went into crafting the treaty as it is, into crafting the common market protocol as it is, into crafting the customs union as it is. And mark you, it's not that everything is not working. There are some elements within these treaties and protocols that are working quite extraordinarily well. But the challenge is that we've refused to allow the capacity to monitor implementation and sanction failure to implement some of these protocols. The protocols are brilliant, well-written pieces of document of legislation that can make a difference in our region and can make us more competitive as a region, especially as we look at the continent. However, they are only as good as their implementation. if they stay protocols without implementation, however much we shout ourselves hoarse, it's not going to happen. And that's where the UMA is coming in then, to say, look, we have the rules. Let's play by them. Because when we play by the rules, it protects you and it protects me. And we're saying, if we have all failed to play by the rules, if everyone else has failed to play by the rules, our appeal to our government then is to say, look, yes, we know you're diplomatic. We know that the Ugandan nature is welcoming, it's diplomatic, we like to be good to our neighbors. But a time comes when you have to decide, do I feed my neighbor's children while mine starve, or do I make a decision to say, look, if you cannot reciprocate, let me also feed my children, you take care of your own.
Doesn't that point to the global nationalism that is cropping up? You're seeing that the same things are happening in the European Union and all the other regional blocs across the world. Don't you think the time has come for all of us to start reflecting on our children and nationalism per se in terms of protecting trade interests?
It's an unfortunate reality of the world we live in. I mean, America had America First for the last 4 years. Viktor Orban in Europe is also pulling an internal look at his own people. But I'm still a firm believer in multilateralism and the impact that multiple forces can bring to bear on processes. I'm only saying that perhaps the language that will be understood, if the language of diplomacy has failed to yield fruits, perhaps we need to think, what other languages can we speak that can get through to our neighbors so they appreciate the issue at hand? Because otherwise, we'll get to a point 5 years from now, look back to today and say, you know what? I wish we had done something then. And by then it will be too late. We'll have no factories here. They'll all have moved to Kenya. We will have no jobs here. We'll probably be running to Kenya to get employment. And that's not what we want. For goodness sake, Vision 2040, brilliant document, talks of us, a first world economy. I mean, NDP3 talks of a manufacturing-led economy. It cannot be manufacturing-led if it doesn't have markets.
You criticized a political-centered integration or bloc in favor of a people-centered bloc or treaty. But everything thrives and fails at the hand of the politicians. Don't you think it is more important to lobby for political will to ensure that there is progress that is made other than castigate the politicians?
I think we've lobbied. We actually have done a lot of lobbying, both in Uganda and at the regional level, on issues politics. So far, they are not yielding much. My castigation of politics and the political-centered process is that we then become captive to five-year terms, sentiments. If there's a disagreement between two leaders, it trickles down to the business side. And my belief is that if we have the structures, they can be immune from any such incidences. Europe, for example. Brexit is happening. The European Union is moving on. You have elections coming up in Germany. It's not affecting the momentum of the European Union and the European integration. France has changed, I don't know how many leaders since they joined, since the European Union was formed. But the system continues to move forward. Brussels runs the show. And this is what we need in East Africa. If we are really pro-East Africa, a pro-people-centered and pro-private sector-driven, private sector and the people are saying, give the power to Arusha. If you give the power to Arusha, whatever happens within your political sphere is not going to trickle down into politics, into economics. Because as you know, money hates noise. Politics has a lot of noise. And that always chases away the money that we get into this country.
My mother in Lugazi wants to sell her sugarcane. Mm. Probably your aunt somewhere in Western Uganda wants to sell their milk. Mm. What is the way forward?
The way forward is your mother, my auntie, Ugandans need to stand up. Like I said, seeing, viewing this through the lens of a manufacturing issue, it's their issue, is something that is not going to be sustainable for us in the long run. Because at the end of the day, the impact of a failure to develop manufacturing in Uganda is going to be felt in our own pockets as Ugandans. Because if you look at our tax contribution, what's the biggest percentage of tax contributors? It's manufacturers, about 60%. If you look at our electricity consumption, biggest percentage is manufacturers. The 13 top consumers of electricity in this country consume more than the rest of the country combined. That just shows you the power manufacturing has in this country. Now, if all those go away, what is the impact? The impact is less jobs, because the people who've been working in factories are certainly seated at home. The supply chains are going to be affected. Manufacturing has been researched to provide four jobs for every one job in the factory. There are four jobs on the outside that are created. All those jobs are out of the way. Distributors, suppliers, kiosks, name it, supermarkets are out of the window. Your roads that you're moving on are funded by taxpayers' money. Who are the biggest parts? So I can go on and on. But the appeal is, let's get up as Ugandans. Let's speak to our politicians. Let's speak to our leaders and tell them, look, this is a ticking time bomb. It's something we needed to resolve yesterday. We missed it. Let's solve it today. Let's ensure that we provide the right support to our manufacturers to access the markets that they need to access, because in the end, it benefits all of us as Ugandans.
With that, let's go for a very short break.